Hello and welcome to the Ladaflow version 2.5 webinar and thank you for accepting the invitation to join. My name's Mike Branchlauer and I'm the Global Sales Manager for Ladaflow. If you're having any problems with the audio pane, please click the audio pane and then sound check, which is highlighted in blue. That will help you through it. It's also some details in the chat, but if you can't hear me, you won't see that, of course. You've got the opportunity to submit questions, so please type them into the question pane at the bottom as we go along. Send them anytime, and we'll answer the questions as soon as we can after we've completed the presentation and demonstration. There's also a Ladaflow product sheet that you can download in the handouts pane at the bottom. I'm now going to hand over to Wouter Dijkhuizen. He's the Ladaflow product champion. What he's going to do is present and demonstrate the improvements that we've made to the core and also the graphical user interface for 2.5. So I'll just hand over now.
Yeah, thank you, Mike, for the introduction. So I hope you can see my screen. So this webinar will be about Ladaflow 2.5, which was released just a few weeks ago. So the contents of this presentation, they are divided in a few different topics. So first of all, the improvements that we've made to the core models or the simulator. So there are some improvements to the multi-phase models and some feature improvements, ranging from improvements for running at near vacuum conditions to the pump model, something for downhole separation and temperature dependent non-Newtonian fluids. Then we have something about the improvements in the graphical user interface. And finally, I will demonstrate a couple of these things. So please note that these are not the only improvements in Ladaflow 2.5, there's more. And if you're interested in knowing more about that, you can have a look at the release notes that you find in the installation. So first off, the improvements to the multi-phase flow models in Ladaflow. So for this release, we've looked at particularly improving the pressure drop for stratified flow. So that means in near horizontal sections of the pipe, and also at high gas Froude numbers, which means either high gas flow rates or high gas densities. So it's a bit different at high density. And then the first improvement that we've made is to introduce a wall film model, as you can see in the picture to the right on this slide. So what we know from our detailed experiments that have been carried out in the Tiller loop in Trondheim, what we know is that at very high gas velocities, some of the liquid will be entrained as droplets, and these droplets, they may deposit on the pipe wall. And then what is mostly interested for us is that this wall film, it will change the wall roughness that is perceived by the gas phase. And then because of this change in perceived wall roughness, this will change the pressure drop quite a bit. So normally the pressure drop will increase because of this wall film. And that is the effect that we're now taking into account in Ladaflow 2.5. So I'll come back with some comparisons showing how this changed the results. Secondly, the transition from separated to mixed oil water flow is now much more accurate. So previously, Ladaflow typically predicted stratified or separated oil water flow for three phase flows under most circumstances in near horizontal pipes. But now this we have a better transition criterion. So for high gas Froude numbers, which means again high gas flow rates or high gas densities, we're now predicting a more correct transition to mixed oil water. So you will get, so at high gas velocities, you will get either dispersed oil in water or water in oil flow. And then this is much closer to what we observe in experiments. So these experiments mainly show that it is the gas phase with high velocities and high shear, which is responsible for mixing the oil and water. So this is also a very important effect that is taken into account in Ladaflow 2.5 now, improving the predictions. And then finally, this is not something specific, but just a word of caution. So this is that since we predict a more accurate oil-water dispersion now with this mixed oil-water, the effect of emulsion models will be much more pronounced. So you can expect much higher effective viscosities and also much higher pressure drop in some cases where this kicks in. So that is important to realize. So it could, for some cases, it could have quite a big effect on the pressure drop. So here are some of the comparisons that we did using our experimental data. So on the left, we have the two-phase data using different fluids for the liquid phase. So the plots at the top, they show the results for naphtha in an 8-inch pipe. We can see that the comparison before and after, it's relatively similar, so not much has changed there. Then below that are the results for Axol. So before and after, the results are not dramatically different, but we can see that the scatter in the data has improved quite a bit. So we get a better match in pressure drop with the experiments. And then most of the improvements we can actually see for the water glycerol data. So that means a mixture of water and glycerol, which means that we have a kind of a viscous liquid phase. We can see that the comparison there has improved much more. So now we have about 90% of the data points are within 10% accuracy compared to the experiment, which is a big improvement from the previous 17% in the within 10%. So this has really improved things quite a lot. If we go to the right, we can see the three-phase data. So here the dotted lines are the comparison with, so those are the numerical results in Leider flow 2.4, and then solid lines, they are the numerical results with Leider flow 2.5, so after the changes. And we can see that the pressure drop has gone up quite a bit in these plots. And the dots over here, they are the experiments, and then so basically we're comparing it against the solid lines, which are the simulations. So we can see for different liquid viscosities and different superficial gas velocities. If we go down, we get a higher gas velocity. So we're expecting this wall film model to be much more important for the lower plots in this comparison. So at a superficial gas velocity of 12 meters per second, we really get a very good comparison between the Leider flow 2.5 predictions and the experiments. And then But at the lower gas velocity, the comparison is also much improved compared to Leider flow 2.4, but there's a bit more scatter in the experimental data there. So there might be some other improvements that we can make in the future, or we need to have a look at the accuracy or of the experiments, because there's some strange behavior going on there. So that's something to be discussed in the future. But overall, it's very clear that this is quite a big step in the improvement of the pressure drop. Okay, then we've made some other improvements to the simulator as well. So one of them is the support for running at near vacuum conditions. So the use case here is really any case that fails due to too low pressure or density. So we have a bunch of different errors that you can get in Leider flow if the density becomes negative or if the pressure becomes negative. And then what should happen in reality in these cases, if the reason for the low pressure or density is physical, is that some of the liquid should evaporate, and then the resulting gas, it should basically fill the void, thereby preventing a vacuum. So we've made some improvements here. So the PVT mass transfer, which is the method that we use to give gas evaporation for black oil and PVT tables. So this has been made more implicit. So it's tighter coupled in the mass equation, which gives much faster evaporation of gas. So this works much better in creating the gas that should fill the void. Also, the extrapolation of the gas density is now improved. At low pressure, we now make sure that the gas density goes to zero exactly at zero pressure. And this is very important because now a tiny amount of gas can be used to prevent vacuum conditions. So you basically get an infinite expansion of gas when necessary. There's also some new options in the GUI. For the black oil PVT, we now have the option of having oil evaporation. So this is a checkbox that can be turned on when you need it. So we already had this from before for PVT tables. But for the PVT tables, we've added the option to evaporate water as well. So this is not available for the black oil PVT because it doesn't have any water vapor in later flow. Some other improvements. So this is mainly about user friendliness. So for the pump, we realized that it's very difficult to obtain pump curves for doing numerical simulations. And this makes it difficult in particular to use the inline separator because you normally need a pump to maintain the liquid level. And then if you have to make up these pump curves, it's very tedious to do. So what we've done is we've introduced an intermediate mode for the pump, which is a little bit more advanced than our simple pump and less advanced than the advanced pump, which uses actual pump curves. So here you can give some simple parameters like the pressure boost, the volume flow rate, the speed, and yeah, that's about it. And then later flow, it uses a correlation for the pump curve and just scales it with the speed of the pump according to some scaling laws that are quite universal for the pump. So this makes it possible to do some to easily do some early stage calculations when you don't know what pump curves exactly look like. So this improves the user friendliness quite a bit. We also have something for downhole separation. Again, this is about user friendliness. So the use case here is to support gas venting in combination with an ESP in a well. So previously people were using an inline separator to model this, but obviously there's no tank separator. It doesn't really capture what goes on downhole in a well. You don't really have the volume of a tank separator there, so we came up with a better way of modeling this, which is much simpler. So there are two different options depending on whether or not you want to simulate the annulus of the well. So the simple option is just using a negative source, which is the red arrow shown on the right. So this is just taking the gas away before the liquid goes through the ESP. So you're not simulating what happens with the gas in the annulus. If you are interested in modeling the annulus, for instance, if you want to have a more accurate prediction of the temperature in the well, then you can use the slightly more advanced version, which is using a leak device with a user-specified phase, which also takes out the gas from the tubing, basically, before it goes through the ESP, and then vents it in the annulus. And then this way you can simulate both the liquid going through the tubing and the gas going through the annulus in one model in a very very simple way without having to use any inline separators or controllers. So this is a big improvement in making this possible in a reasonable way. Then the temperature-dependent non-Newtonian fluid. So from before, later flow already had the Herschel-Bulkley equation for modeling non-Newtonian fluids, but this was not enough if you want to do mud circulation in wells or well cleanups, because the geothermal gradient can be give quite a big difference in temperature between the top of the well and the bottom of the well. So that's why we've extended this by combining it with the Arrhenius equation. So there's one extra parameter D, which now accounts for the temperature dependence. And by default, this parameter is zero. So it's exactly the same as before. So by default, this parameter doesn't do anything. And if you have experimental data for your drilling mud, we have shown that for both oil and water-based drilling muds, we can get a very good prediction by fitting this D parameter. So on the right is just a small example of this. It shows that this Herschel-Bulkley equation in its modified form that we have now, we can get a very good match in a wide range of temperatures for this drilling mud. So in this case, it gives a very good fit between a temperature of 4 degrees Celsius and 130 degrees Celsius, so over a very wide range. Then some GUI improvements. So some of this I will demonstrate. So we now have an Excel add-in, which makes it possible to extract output from your simulations easily into Excel. So you can now extract this data directly from the database. No need to use any intermediate files. And also it is capable of reading our backup files. So those have the .qz extension. So you can read those directly using the Excel tool as well. It's possible to have comments associated with pipes, devices, and boundaries. So it's possible to add notes, for instance, using this, or add some hyperlinks to where the documentation is located, just helping to understand why the model is configured a certain way. It's also possible to merge pipes and models now. I will demonstrate that afterwards. So it's possible to merge two pipes into one, which improves the calculation speed slightly. And it's possible to model to merge two models into one, thereby forming an integrated model, which can be useful, for instance, when several people are working on the same project. Then the well builder improvements. So this is our tool for building wells with completions. So it's now possible to use a pipe weight instead of the inner and outer diameter of the tubing and casing. And we've added an easy option to add formation layers on the outside of the casing. So that basically adds the rocks surrounding the well to the thermal model. And then finally, we have a smaller file size for recorded animations with a new file format for an extra small file size, which is WebM, which is particularly suited for internet use. Okay, then we come to the demonstration. So I'll demonstrate the Excel add-in, the pipe and model merging, and the well builder improvements. So let's start with the Excel add-in. So when you enable this in Excel, it will show up as an additional tab in Excel, so which is called Ladder Flow. So we have several options here. So you can import results. Once you've imported results, it's possible to refresh them, for instance, when the simulation has been rerun. And it's possible to create plots with this. So if we import the results, then yeah, those of you familiar with Ladderflow will notice that it looks very familiar to the case browser in the Ladderflow GUI. So that is on purpose. So this will give you access to exactly the same cases that you can see in the Ladderflow GUI, but without having to actually go through the Ladderflow GUI to extract the data. That is the advantage here. So you can just browse here, and then you can see your different Ladderflow cases that are available. So this tool, it supports normal cases as well as parametric studies. They can also be used for data extraction. So if you take this case as an example, so you can extract both profile and trend data. So I know this is a slugging case. So let's have a look at what happens at the inlet and the outlet. So if we get the pressure at the inlet, and well, let's have a look at the mass flow rate of liquid at the outlet, then we should be able to see some traces of this slugging behavior. So it's possible to extract multiple variables at the same time. So if I click OK now, I will get the pressure and the total liquid mass flow rate. So it's read directly from the database in Ladderflow. And it's also possible to create some simple plots like this. So if you want to plot both of these variables in a single plot, that's possible. And then we end up with a plot like this. So obviously it's possible to do this in the Ladderflow GUI, but the advantage of extracting the data here is that it makes it easy to do your own post-processing or maybe customize your plots whenever that is necessary. Yeah, so that's it basically on the Excel add-in. Then let's go back to Ladderflow. So the second thing I want to demonstrate is how to merge cases. So let me just delete this result. So I've prepared here a case consisting of a flow line. So this is just a simple single pipe flow line. And I have a second case which consists of a well with a reservoir inflow and a gas source for the gas lift. Now let's say I want to model this as an integrated simulation, which has the advantage of coupling the pressure between the models at the wellhead. So this wellhead will be merged for both of the models. Then it's possible if you select both cases in the case browser and then right click on them and do merge cases. then it will check if the cases are compatible with each other. So you need to have the same PVT and some other settings. Then let's call it merged case. And then the case settings in this case are taken from the flow line. So let's say in case the thermal options are not compatible between the cases, it will just take the settings from one of the two cases, which is okay. Now it's working on this. So and now I end up with a merged case, which contains both my flow line as well as the well. And now the second step that I can do to make this an integrated model is if you right click on this pressure node and then select merge nodes, then you can merge it with the wellhead from this pipe. Yeah, and now I have in two simple steps, I have an integrated model which contains both the well as, and together with the flow line. So this makes it very easy to deal with several different models and merge them together into an integrated model. Then the last thing I want to demonstrate is the well builder. So this is our tool that we already had for modeling wells. So if we go here, so the well builder is located in the pipe plugin over here. So we've made some small changes here. So now it's possible to change between the old definition, which was using the inner diameter and the outer diameter of the casing and tubing. So it's instead of that, it's now possible to give the pipe weight, which is literally what it says. So this specifies the, so instead of using the inner diameter, you can now specify how much the pipe weighs per meter of pipe. So every meter of pipe in this case, it weighs, for instance, 150 kilograms. So that's an alternative way of defining the dimensions of the different casings and tubing. And then the second thing that we've changed here is now there's a box over here, which you can turn on and off, which is for accounting for the formation around the well. So this will allow you to add a material around the well. So in this case, we get 10 layers with a total thickness of 10 meters of rock around the well if I turn this on. So let's see what happens if I do that. It's telling me that the walls have been updated. So here I can see the effect of this. So the well is still the same as before, basically. So you can see the tubing and the different casings they are present here. But also it's it has added now these different layers of rock around the well. So and this is an exponentially increasing layer size, which gives the best accuracy for the thermal calculations. So basically, before in Lederflow, you had to do this manually, but now it's possible to do this through the well builder, which is much more efficient and easy to use. Okay, that concludes this demonstration. So back to you, Mike, for maybe some questions.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Wouter. So we'll now get into the Q&A session. So far, looks like we've only got one question, though, which is related to the slides that Wouter has presented, asking whether a copy will be sent out. The answer to that really is that within a day you should have an email which will give you access to this recording. So that's the best way to access the slides. If you specifically want the slides in PDF, I would just send me an email and we'll send by return. But hopefully the copy of the video is more valuable with Wouter explaining everything on the slides as well, and you'll get to see the demonstration at the end. Has anyone else got any questions they'd like to send to us? Okay, here's a few more. Good question for you, Wouter. How do you actually activate the Excel add-in?
Yep, that is a good question.
Yeah.
We've actually described that in the user manual. Maybe that's easiest to show.
Yeah.
Let's see, Excel add-in. Yeah. So is shown here under enabling the add-in in Excel. So you just need to go through these steps, basically. So there's two different ways. So you can follow this recipe, but if you're a little bit more advanced user, then you can also turn on the developer tab in Excel, which gives you access to Visual Basic. So I'm thinking probably a lot of you are actually using this if you're using macros in Excel. Then it's easier to actually edit because you can go through this Excel add-ins over here. And this is where you can specify the where you can load. You can just browse basically to where the Excel add-in is. So it's it's located in the Ladderflow folder. So if you have Ladderflow over here, then it's this XLAM file, which is the add-in. So it's in the Ladderflow main folder.
Okay, very good.
You can just add it like this, and then make sure it's enabled. And then if you click OK, it will create this toolbar over here, and then you can use it. So it's as easy as that.
That's good. Okay, next question. Is it part of the Ladderflow license? I guess the answer to that is yes.
Yep. So there's no special license protection for this Excel add-in. So if you have a valid Ladderflow license, it works. And also, if your license has expired, you have this grace period afterwards where you can still get the data from Ladderflow, and then the Excel add-in also still works. Mm-hmm. So you can use it a little bit after your license expires even.
Yeah, so we tend to include everything we can with Ladderflow, all the different functionality that you've seen in previous webinars, Wax, Hydrates, Slug Capturing, everything's included. Need to show where they can find the file with the template. I guess this is all related to the Excel add-in. Where can we get the file with the template? I think that's related to finding the... okay, we'll leave those for the moment. Any other questions from anyone? I think we've answered the last two questions probably while the third one was being answered. So, okay, well, we're nearly out of time. We've got a couple of minutes left. So thank you, Wouter, and thank you for everyone for attending. You should get a follow-up, or you will get a follow-up email if the system is working correctly within one day. So you can then review the webinar again. And if you find you've got any questions or you want any other information on Ladderflow, then please just send me an email and I'll be more than happy to talk to you. On behalf of Kongsberg, thank you for joining the webinar. And we hope to see you at the next one. We aim to do these at least once a quarter. And we'll be in touch about the next one. Enjoy the rest of your day. Goodbye.